Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the session. Just a kind reminder to please switch off your mobile phones and other noise-making devices. Our next talk is by Dr. Hendrik Niemeyer from Rosen, who will talk about synthetic data for machine learning. Let's give him a warm welcome.
Thank you for the introduction. Hello, my name is Hendrik, and I'm here to talk to you about synthetic data for machine learning today. So why do I want to talk to you about synthetic data? So the usual narrative today is that we live in the age of big data and have enormous amounts of data available. But I want to present to you a use case where we have a big amount of unlabeled data, which is insanely costly to label. And so we rely on synthetic data from simulations and generative models to enhance our machine learning models. And this is essentially what I want to talk to you about. So just some quick words about me before I start. So I majored in physics, and I'm now a data scientist for Rosen, working mainly on this project, but some others as well. And here are some ways if you want to contact me. So you could follow me on Twitter or write me an email if you're interested in the talk. But you could also come by our booth today, because Rosen is the sponsor of the conference. So if you have any detailed questions which we can't handle in the Q&A, please come by our booth, also if you're interested in our projects. So I will just spend one or two slides on what the company Rosen is, because many people don't know it, or you may have never heard it before, I guess. So Rosen is a company founded more than 35 years ago by Hermann Rosen, with a strong engineering focus, and has a diverse business portfolio, including pipeline diagnostics, which is the use case or project I'm talking about today, and is a market leader in pipeline inspection since 2008. And the company has always had a strong background in research and development, and I'm talking about a very interesting research and development project today where we use synthetic data. Fast. So, as I just said, the Rosen Group has a diverse business portfolio. I don't want to go into details here, just I want to mention I work for pipeline diagnostics, but there are also very many other interesting fields. So if you're interested in other stuff than pipeline inspections, you could also come talk to our booth and talk to our guys there about the other stuff Rosen does. And yeah, that's mainly it about the company. So what are main technologies we work with? So usually pipeline inspections, I will explain what pipeline inspection is in a few minutes, but usually the technologies we use are not much known. So ultrasound is something many people know, but other stuff like eddy currents or magnetic flux leakage measurement or EMAT are not known. So we have a diverse portfolio of technologies we use, but this talk mainly focuses on analyzing data coming from magnetic flux leakage measurement, which is essentially image-like data. So you could see this as a computer vision talk, and I will explain this now. So let me first start with explaining what a pipeline inspection is. So usually, a pipeline operator needs to know the health status of the pipelines they own. So they have to perform measurements to predict the risk of pipeline failure, for example. And this is done using a pipeline inspection, where a measurement device called a PIC is inserted into the pipeline while the pipeline is still in operation, and a huge amount of measurement is performed. So let me just give you a quick overview of the number. So you can say in a pipeline, every millimeter along the whole circumference, a measurement is made. So if you imagine a 100 or 200 kilometer pipelines and a measurement every millimeter along the whole circumference, this is a whole lot of data we can measure. And this is, since I said you have two dimensions, the flow direction and the circumference, you have at least image-like data. It's not images. You have two dimensions in space, the x and the y axis, and then at every measurement point, for example, in the technology I use, an amplitude, which is depicted here in the last image, for example.
Sorry.
So, and so let me just explain what the data is I work with. So magnetic flux leakage measurement means that you have, when the tool is inside the pipeline, then you have a pipe wall consisting of steel, for example, or in most cases of steel. Then you magnetize the steel wall, and then using a Hall sensor, you measure if there is any magnetic field outside the pipe wall. And the theory behind this measurement principle is that if the pipeline wall is not homogeneous, but has some defects like corrosion or a crack, some magnetic field will leak outside of the wall and can be measured using this Hall sensor. And this is essentially what is depicted in the last image here. You have the measurement of an amplitude for every x and y coordinate and get this image-like data. And what do we do with this data? So we perform classical computer vision tasks. We do object detection, object classification, and from the classified objects, we try to estimate the real dimension of the defect causing the signal, because such a magnetic measurement is an indirect measurement. So this is, in principle, the basic measurement principle. So, and it's like images, but not completely, because you measure amplitudes, not RGB values, but you can use classical computer vision techniques here. But the interesting part here is not the data. The data is also interesting, but that the getting ground truths or gathering ground truths for this data is extremely hard and extremely costly. And I will make a comparison to getting ground truths in computer vision applications now. So how would you gather ground truth data if you set up a new project for a computer vision problem? So if it's a completely new project, you would acquire a large set of images, for example, from the web, and then use Amazon Mechanical Turk or bachelor students or interns, if you're in a company, to label your data. And this may seem costly to you, because I looked it up. The average cost of labeling an image on Amazon Mechanical Turk is 30 cents. This may sound costly if you want to label a million images for example, rebuilding ImageNet. But it's affordable, for example, for a company or large university project. And then you have your complete ground truth and can do everything you want with it. There are no problems there. Maybe bad quality from the labeler, but nothing else. But what happens if we now look at pipelines? So how do we get ground truth there? And this is much more complicated, because where is a pipeline usually located? Mostly underground. So what do we have to do to get the data? A pipeline needs to be dug up to get access to the wall, to the pipe wall, and then the entire pipe wall has to be scanned using a 3D laser scanner to get a profile. And from this profile, you can infer if there is something which is considered a defect, what kind of defect it is, and its dimensions. You can see it here in the picture, so dug up pipeline, then some defect marked by a white square. And this is not the end. If you have acquired this 3D laser scan, you have to align it to the measured data. Because, as I just said, such a pipeline could be 100, 200, 300, 400 kilometers long, and then you have to match the data. So you have to match real coordinates to the coordinates measured by your pigging tool. And this is all stuff which costs money. So if you did research there, if you look up what digging up a pipeline costs, you're getting your several hundred thousands of dollars for such a dig up and the scanning and the alignment. So building up a data set which would be as large as ImageNet, for example, isn't affordable even for a large company. So you will always live in a world where you have big data in the sense of unlabeled data, but small data in the sense of labeled data. And this is the problem I have to deal with in my daily work, because I want to use this data to build machine learning models for these computer vision tasks. So here's just a comparison again. If we have image data in classical computer vision tasks, anyone can label my data, usually. For inline inspection data, I need a human expert aligning the data for me. It's not very costly to label image data, but very costly to get ground truth data for pipeline inspections. And usually, if I have a large set of images, every image can be labeled somehow. But getting the ground truth from pipelines, I have to talk to the customer for dig ups. Not every location is available for such a dig up. It could be in a swamp, it could be underground. And the data is inherently imbalanced, because I cannot say before I want to get this kind of data, which has been measured with this kind of sensor. I have to take what I get. So I have, so to say, class imbalance or sparsity according to parameters defining my defect, my sensor, and many other parameters. So now we'll just show you a diagram of how such a class imbalance could look like. So here is an image of the ground truth data we have gathered for some time from different customers. And on the x-axis is the length of such a defect, and on the y-axis is the width. It's not very important what the axes mean, but what is interesting is that here are several fields marked in different colors, which mean different classes of defects. And what you can clearly see from gathering the data is that not every class imaginable is covered here, because I cannot say I want, for example, some category dug up. I cannot say this beforehand most often. Another kind of class imbalance or sparsity in parameter space could, for example, be the pipeline parameters, not the defect parameters. So if I dig up a pipeline, I cannot say beforehand I want to dig up a pipeline which has this and that wall thickness. I have to take what I get. So I have many data for some wall thicknesses and very small data for others. And this is essentially what makes up the need for us to gather synthetic data to enhance our small data set. So let me now talk a little bit about the workflow for synthetic data we use and which we find practical. So the first step is not very sophisticated. You have to generate synthetic data somehow. This has to be the starting point. So this could be simulations or generative machine learning models. I will talk about both now. And then the interesting point starts. So what is the quality of synthetic data? How can I check if my data really comes close to what I've measured in reality? So, and if my simulated data or my synthetic data is close to real data, I'm practically finished. I can train my machine learning model, do some cross-validation and testing, and I can be happily and deploy a model which I can use for my customer. But what happens if my synthetic data does not come close to my real data which I've measured? Then should I give up? Well, you could give up, but you don't need to. There are also methods for refining synthetic data, and I will talk about two state-of-the-art methods here which you can use to refine synthetic data if there is need for it. So how to generate synthetic data? So the first part is what I just said, simulations. And here is my use case. I've talked about a magnetic flux leakage measurement, which is an electrodynamic problem. So I can do FEM, finite element simulations. So this, if you have simulations available, this is always good, because you need no training data for an FEM simulation or some other physical simulation. You just need someone to build up the simulation for you. This is usually not the data scientist. You need a simulation expert for this, but you need no training data for it. And the nice thing is you can set the parameters of your simulation. So where you have class balance, as in the diagrams I showed before, you can say, okay, now I want a simulation exactly there where I don't have data. I can set this. And the only issue is that a simulation takes time. There's a trade-off between accuracy and computing time, and there's the need for someone who can build up the simulations. So, just an example from us, I will talk about more general simulations soon. We went from about 7,000 dug up real defect data to more than 1 million FEM simulations, covering all the areas where we had data missing, or class imbalance, so to say, regarding the defect parameters, the pipeline parameters, sensor parameters, and so on. It's just, you don't have to understand the numbers. Here is just a takeaway that you can multiply your data by several orders of magnitudes with simulations. So, what are other kinds of simulations in computer vision problems, for example? So, talk about a very specific problem here, because not everyone is dealing with electrodynamic problems and can use FEM simulations. Also, in classical computer vision applications, there are use cases for synthetic data. For example, last year on the ECCV, there was a talk on using GTA 5 to generate ground truth data for semantic segmentation, which is very interesting because semantic segmentation is one of the computer vision tasks for which is the most hard, or the hardest part is to get the labeling, because every pixel has to be labeled, and this is very time consuming. And there they used GTA 5, which is essentially a computer game which you can drive around, to get this data set, and they didn't know, or they didn't have access to the source code, but they inferred the labeling from the communications between the graphics card and the actual game. So another example for synthetic data or simulations is the first ever machine learning paper released by Apple about gaze prediction, where they said, okay, we want to build a machine learning model which can predict if someone is looking at his iPhone or her iPhone or not. And they had a simulator which can produce an image of a human eye and then use this with some refinement for training such a model. And something which I find very interesting, at least for a classical computer vision application, is Unreal CV, which is a plugin for the Unreal Engine, where you can just, in the engine, design your scene and then define what kind of ground truth you want to get. So this is a picture on the bottom left here. There's a scene defined, and for example, a semantic segmentation ground truth is produced, or a depth map is produced, or surface normals, for example. So simulations are not limited to really physics problems like my problem, but also happening in computer vision applications. So, but what can we do if no simulations are available? Because maybe we don't have a physics problem and we don't know anything about the process which generates our data. So something which has really gained popularity in the last few years are generative adversarial networks, or GANs, and they can also be used to generate synthetic data. Because what a GAN does, I don't know if everyone knows what a GAN does, so I will explain it. A GAN is a very interesting generative model in a way, because it combines two models fighting each other. You have a generator model, which, given as input some vector of random numbers, will generate a synthetic data example. So this is the generative part. And the second model is a discriminator, which is a classifier, which tries to classify whether the data presented to it is real or synthetic. So it tries to figure out if the data is real or not. And by combining these two models with a loss function and let them fight each other, you can find, if everything converges, a really good generator. Because during training, the generator tries to get better and better at producing synthetic data, while the discriminator tries to get better and better at discriminating real and synthetic data, leading, if convergence happens, to a very good model. And this is, as you can see here in the pictures, be used to create synthetic data, for example, here for an MNIST dataset or for a FACES dataset. But what is the downside of such a model? So you need, of course, training data, but GANs can live with very little training data. So there are examples in the literature where people train GANs, for example, with 500 images. And the second disadvantage you have here is that you have no control about parameters of your data. So here, if I generate, for example, handwritten digits from the MNIST dataset, synthetic MNIST data, I will get every digit somehow. I cannot say to the GAN, please only give me twos, because I have too few twos in my dataset. I will get everything. And this becomes important if you have a huge parameter space for your data, like in pipeline inspection data where I've talked about defect classes or pipeline parameters. You usually want to control what data you get out of a simulation or a generative model. But there are also ways to modify GANs in a way that you can feed in extra parameters. And this architecture, or this class of architecture, is called conditional GANs, or because you condition the GAN on some parameters to generate you data. One example here is, for example, the PIX2PIX architecture from last year, where you, instead of feeding the generator random numbers, you feed it a feature vector, which contains the parameter you want to use to create data. And here are some examples from the PIX2PIX paper. For example, one CGAN they trained is getting as input data for the conditioning a semantic segmentation of the scene, and then the generator tries to produce an image of the scene. Or you give it a semantic segmentation of a facade and you get an image of a building out. Or you can use it for colorization. Or you can give it an edge image and get the real image out of it. Or the other way around, however you want to do it. And this is interesting because if you can condition on the input, you can control the data you get out of the model. So this is here not examples from my work, but we are using this PIX2PIX architecture as well. But instead of giving it, for example, a segmentation as input, we give as input the parameters which are interesting for us. For example, the defect geometry and the parameters of the pipeline and the sensor to get exactly the data from such a generative model we want to counterbalance our class imbalance here. So this is now, what do we do if we have generated synthetic data for us? So the next step is to check the quality of the data. So why do we need to check the quality? Because there's something which is in the literature generally called the synthetic gap. We don't know if the distribution of our synthetic data and our real data in some feature space does match. We don't know it beforehand. And if we don't check for this gap and just say, okay, I have synthetic data, let's try and train our fancy classifier on this data, the classifier just might learn artifacts from the synthetic data which are not present in the real data. And such a model will fail in the real world where it gets presented real data, which does not contain these artifacts, which might be in the synthetic data. And so how do we check it? So the easiest way is to do visual inspection. If you generate images, you can just look at them. This is the naive approach, because from looking at an image, you might discover some artifacts, but you might also not. So there are other, let's say, more advanced methods for looking at real and synthetic data together. So there is one visualization technique, which is very handy for looking at the real and synthetic data together. So it's TDIBS, stochastic neighborhood embedding, or TSNE. It's also a state-of-the-art visualization technique. I think most of you will know that. So the idea there is that you have a nonlinear dimension reduction, which is specifically designed for visualization. So the algorithm itself will work in a way that you, if you look at it in 2D or 3D, will get a plot, which, for example, for a classification problem, tends to cluster the data in the reduced space by its classes. So you can see this image of MNIST here on the slide, where the data clusters in 2D according to the digit it, the data represents. So the ones are by the ones, the twos are by the twos, etc. Usually this is also a good plot for feature engineering to look how good your features work for separating different classes, but you can also use this visualization or dimension reduction technique to look at real and synthetic data together. Because if you have this synthetic gap, your synthetic data in such a visualization could behave like a different class compared to real data. So here is the plot from a very interesting paper from Zeng et al., who are working also on synthetic data for computer vision. So here you can see if you, for example, on the left side, have a bad simulation, which here the simulated or synthetic data is shown in red, in blue, and the real data in red, then they don't cluster together very much. You can, if you colorize the image by the class real and synthetic, you see they tend to not cluster together, but if you, like in the right picture, have a very good simulation, the real and synthetic data are very near each other in the plot and cluster together. But this is, of course, not a conclusive approach, it's just a visual, also some kind of visual inspection, but a little bit more advanced. Because it's not conclusive. If you might have something like the right picture here in your for your data, that real and synthetic data cluster together, but this does not mean that they are not different in some other way. It's just a hint that you are on the right way with your simulation or generative model you used for producing this data. But this TSNE visualization is something we find very helpful for checking the synthetic data. So one other, a little bit more sophisticated approach is borrowing an idea from the gun. So as I just said, the gun has this generator and this discriminator, and usually in the end you only use the generator for generating new data and forget that you ever had this discriminator model. But you can also say, I'm interested in such a discriminator. You can build it by hand. You can try to build a classifier which tries to discriminate between your real and your synthetic data in some feature space you're interested in or in general. And if you fail to do so, that is a very good indication that you don't have a synthetic gap. Because if you cannot find a classifier in the feature space you are interested in to separate real and synthetic data from one another, then they are not separable in this feature space and look alike, so to say, or are not very different and therefore usable for model and development. And you can use this classification error from such a model as a quantitative measure for the quality of your synthetic data. Well, it's a hint of the quality for your synthetic data. You can, of course, never be sure that your data is good. So the next step in the workflow is refinement. What do we do if we are, let's say, we've generated our data, we have looked at it, and we have seen, okay, we have in our simulations or our generative model some artifacts or differences to real data we cannot get rid of. Then, of course, we could stop, or we can look at refinement models or using models for the refinement. So I will just talk about two models you can use for refining synthetic data. One is we can go back to the conditional gun. We can say, okay, instead of giving a gun parameters as input which interest us for generating data, so a defect geometry in my case, or in the computer vision case, an edge picture, for example, you can go and say, okay, what happens if I try to train a conditional gun, which uses as conditional input the simulated data, and try to train it to produce as realistic synthetic data using a bad simulation or a not so good simulation. This might work out, and there are papers in the literature which are doing that, and then you might have better synthetic data in the end generated from a not so good simulation. So in principle, you could also use every other generative model which can be conditioned on some input. So another example from the literature which is recent and seems to be state of the art is using, for example, autoencoders, because they also work on corresponding pairs of real and simulated data. And then you can try and use an autoencoder to learn the mapping from a not so good simulation to the real data and refine your synthetic data. So such an example from the literature could be, for example, a multi-channel autoencoder, which is just two autoencoders with a shared hidden layer. One autoencoder learns the mapping from synthetic data to real data for corresponding pairs, and the other autoencoder, which shares the hidden layer of neurons with the first autoencoder, learns the mapping from the real data to the real data. And by sharing the hidden layer, you enforce similarity in the mapping and get, hopefully, if everything works out and converges, better synthetic data here. So, but there's one caveat to this refinement methods. All these models I've shown here and most other stuff you can do with generative models for refining synthetic data works on corresponding pairs. So you need, for example, real data and a synthetic example which corresponds to the real data to learn this mapping, to get rid of your artifacts. So usually if you have a simulation, you can just simulate the data you've measured. This should be no problem. But if there for some reason no possibility to generate corresponding pairs of real and synthetic data, these methods might be not usable for you. So in the end, so I just said if everything went well and we have good simulations or simulations which are good after refinement, then we can just train a machine learning model and be done with it. But I will not stop here. There are also some machine learning techniques which are specifically tailored for such tasks where you have two different training sets as input, which might differ a little bit. So I will talk a little bit about them too. Because of course you can just say, I have my good data now. I will just train my convolutional neural network and be done with it. But maybe there's also a use case for these specific methods here. And you can borrow ideas from transfer learning and domain adaption for synthetic data too. So let me just talk a little bit about what transfer learning or domain adaption is. This is usually, most often you see papers in the computer vision community where they say, okay, I have my pre-trained network, which for example is trained on ImageNet and can discriminate between cars and dogs, but now I need a model which does not say this is only a dog, but says this is a Labrador retriever and I don't know, this is some other kind of dog. And this is, of course, you could build up a training set and train with a new data set, but the idea of transfer learning or domain adaption is that you already have a pre-trained model and can adapt it to a new specific task. And this idea you can also borrow and use for synthetic data. Because the main idea is you have two training sets which differ a little bit in their distribution in some feature space, but you can train easily on one of the training sets and just want to refine on the other. So you can do something very simple. You could just, for example, take this idea and say, okay, I train my model on my huge synthetic data set for some iterations, and then the last few iterations I add or swap for my real data, and use the model which comes out in the end. So this is usually called fine-tuning. In the literature for convolutional neural networks, it's also applicable for other models which you can train iteratively. And there are also ideas where you just modify the loss function of your problem. Because usually you have a loss function which just says, okay, I want to minimize classification error, regression error. But there is a talk from this ICCV, which just happens in parallel to the PyCon, where they suggested the idea that you can modify your loss function. You add a similarity loss. You just and the similarity loss enforces a similarity of the representation in the hidden layers of your model for the synthetic and the real data. So I will not go into details here. You can look at these years' ICCV papers. But the idea is basically that you say, okay, I need to have a good performance in the end on my data, but also the hidden representation needs to be similar for real and synthetic data for my model, because this is what I expect. If I have real and synthetic data, which should be exactly the same in some feature space distribution, then the hidden representation should be very similar in such, for example, convolutional neural network, but also applicable to other models. So, and what is the last step? Cross-validation and testing. There are no special methods here needed for synthetic data. You just do cross-validation and testing, but there are also some caveats we encountered in our daily work. So if there are, for example, these corresponding pairs of real and synthetic data, then don't train on one and put the other in a test set, although they are different items, because they are basically the same items. And this idea holds also true if they are not corresponding pairs, but just a little bit shifted in some parameter space, a little bit different in a wall thickness, for example, for inline inspection data. And yeah, synthetic data in general does not belong in a test set. Well, this is at least my experience. So, coming to my conclusion now. Synthetic data can be helpful to increase the performance of your machine learning model. If you live in a world where you have only small data available and you cannot label new data, or it costs too much or takes too much time, and this gap between real and synthetic data has always to be checked in order to be sure that your model will not overfit on some artifacts of your synthetic data. And just to mention that we are doing this, what is our success story with it? We have gone from about 6,000 or 7,000 real training items to over 1,000,000 with simulations and careful checking, and we got a huge increase in performance for our automated data evaluation of this magnetic flux leakage data. So of course there are alternatives to doing simulations. For example, in the case that you have small data labeled, but also this big pool of unlabeled data available, and labeling is not that costly. You could also use methods like active learning or semi-supervised learning, which we employ for other problems. But if labeling is very costly, then synthetic data can be helpful. So, and yeah, this concludes my talk. I invite you to come to our booth to talk to us about if you're interested in such problems. And yeah, we are also hiring data scientists, data engineers, software engineers. If you're interested, come by, talk to us. And yeah, I would like to take your questions now.
Okay, are there any questions?
So many questions. I think it was brilliant presentation. It's just so interesting, like, because I have very similar problem, let's say, in the thing I'm working in, and I can feel your pain, let's say, because people who work in universities, some people, they don't know what is happening with the data and how hard is it to get the data. So I think it was very good. Could you please go to slide 14? I wanted to ask you, what exactly did you mean by Okay, what did you want to say with this slide? Because I couldn't understand, unfortunately.
So this slide is, I just wanted to give you numbers on how much FEM simulations we created. So you have here in this table just two categories of FEM simulations based on duck-up data and based on geometry we sort up ourselves. And here's some parameter range we defined. So the idea is just to say we created a huge number of FEM simulations and we're able to freely set the parameters of interest in these simulations and got good synthetic data. So it's, the actual numbers here aren't that important. It's just to give you an idea that we can or were able to create a really large data set with FEM simulations and we're able to use it.
Also, I would ask you, so could you go to the slide where you were showing that the synthetic data in the TSNE space, that it's really similar, like on the right they were really similar? Yeah, exactly. My question here would be, so you say, of course, if there is a big gap between synthetic and real data, this is a problem. But also I'm thinking if you have the synthetic data which exactly copies the real data, it's also bad because you don't want two instances. Like, why do you need a copy of real data, right? So how do you like distinguish if the gap is, when the gap is too big, when it's still, when synthetic data is still okay to be as real, or if it's already too different? How do you distinguish?
Yeah, the problem here that this synthetic gap is a really diffuse problem. It's really hard to say when it's too big or when it's not too big. So usually you have, or you are fearing a too big gap. And so what we usually do is try to close the gap by inspecting the data or verifying the data. And then doing further testing phases on new real evaluated data sets, see if you got a performance increase from models which were only trained on the real data. So you could see an extended workflow could be like, so you have your real data set, your synthetic data set, you say, okay, I've closed the synthetic gap or there was never one. And then in the end, if you get new data and test on this new data, you can test two different models. You can test your model with synthetic data in it and your model just based on the few real training examples you have. And if you see a huge performance increase there, then you have added valuable synthetic data to your data set. I think it's really hard to do it otherwise, unless you have some very good idea you please tell me right now.
No, I'm not. Anyone has questions? Or I would have a few more if no one has. But.
So this method is really cool. But I'm wondering, it sort of adds another layer which could produce an error. And I'm wondering if there's any way to understand what that error is and how to calculate that, and if there's a way to sort of mitigate that. And then related to that, does this, if you're already generating a simulation, would it be possible to skip the machine learning altogether and use your simulation developed rules without the machine learning error as well?
Yeah. So let me just answer your last question first. If you have a very good model for the forward direction, so give it some geometry and some sensor and produce then a very, very good measurement example, synthetic measurement example, you can think of skipping machine learning and doing black box optimization. And this is some idea we already have and discuss at our company, but this is somehow more complicated than a machine learning problem, because, for example, an FEM simulation has no derivative, so to say. You cannot calculate a derivative of an FEM simulation and do some gradient descent, for example. You need black box optimization techniques, which are hard, but we are trying to do this already, so. It's a black box optimization, but in machine learning models, you have a derivative. If you have a convolutional neural network, you have a derivative and then do gradient descent. Yeah, but there are, for example, if you have, let me explain it this way. If you have a simulation which takes some parameters as input, then does some stuff you have no access to, and then generates your synthetic data, and assuming the synthetic data exactly matches the real data, you could think of going backwards by doing an optimization. But usually for an optimization to work or to be very easily, you have to have a gradient, which you don't have here. And right now I have to stop, apparently. But we can talk about it afterwards.
Okay, thank you. I'm so sorry. Thank you for a very interesting presentation. Let's give him another round of applause.